And the category of the intern has its own suite of tests and compliance issues. Can you tell us about those, please?
You need to have an agreement that lays out the terms of the relationship, explains to the intern that they're not entitled to wages, that they're also not entitled to a job at the end of the training program. You need to make sure that you clearly define the training program and make sure that that's in writing, that it's legitimate, that it looks like a vocational training program that you may have at University of New Hampshire Cooperative Extension.
So it might be a good idea to show them, here's a 6-point test.
And put that in the contract.
We're gonna put that in the contract so you understand you are an intern, not an employee.
For sure. And you wanna make sure that you abide by the workplace safety requirements of OSHA. That applies even if the worker technically is not an employee. Also, there's certain tax compliance issues, and this applies if the wages you decide to pay are wages as opposed to a stipend. A stipend is a nominal payment that it covers only the intern's out-of-pocket expenses and other traveling expenses incurred during the internship period. Housing and meals. For tax purposes, now these may be deductible as a business expense. There's a test that we'll cover in the legal guide. If they're not a business expense, they're gonna be taxed as compensation and they need to be reported accordingly.
So the intern, I think it was point four that really caught me. Mm-hmm. The farm can get no economic gain. It's simply educational.
That's right.
So the moment that I take my education and apply it, pulling weeds, milking cows, driving tractor, mm-hmm. I really am acting as an employee.
You are.
And so, and Christy had mentioned in the record keeping aspect of it, that I might actually differentiate on the record. So from 8 to noon, I am following a farmer around, just gaining education and building skills mm-hmm. and whatnot. Maybe trying, driving the tractor for a little bit just to get the hang of it. Mm-hmm. But the moment that I'm sent out to go to a job, maybe 1 to 5, mm-hmm. I would then be on record as a employee.
That's right.
And so different compliance issues would apply, but you're also saying that the categories really aren't mutually exclusive of mm-hmm. each other. I have to understand as an employer and employee what I'm acting under.
That's a very good way of putting it. And I think that is a system that you could put in place. If you have the record keeping to back it up, you can definitely do it.
So, and then that would mean that you have, when you're maintaining your compliance for the different job classifications, for example, workers' compensation could be an issue, because it's true that workers' compensation is not mandatory for an intern. However, it is mandatory for an employee. So you want to make sure if you have this one person in the two different roles as an employee half the day and as an intern the other half of the day, if that works out for that person, you want to make sure that you talk to your insurance provider and make sure that sort of arrangement is covered, and they're covered the entire time. Because even though they're an intern and they may be exempt half the day from workers' compensation, it's still a best practice to have them covered under your workers' compensation policy just to protect your own farm and personal assets.
So if I'm an intern and I get hurt, and the farm is liable and even more vulnerable than if I was an employee, in which I had to have the workman's comp.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So it's a risk management strategy.
Yes.
It is, yeah.
And it comes back to defining what category of worker you have on your farm, and then speaking with your accountant and your insurance agent at a minimum, mm-hmm. and then even running these things by your lawyer, preferably.
Mm-hmm. Yes.